say from the 60s. Round, round, get around, I get around. 70s. On 102.5 The Bridge. Yeah!
old and take me back. Adam, that takes me back to a lovely time of the 80s.
Makes me
feel old.
It takes me back to the rehearsal room last week when I was I'm doing rehearsing a couple of those songs, Kings of M-Music.
Absolutely.
Trying to get them right.
So let us go back to the beginning of your musical career. How did it all begin for you?
It began in London, in the clubs in London in sort of 77. We did a first gig around August 77, and it was all happening in London. And I'd seen Sex Pistols about 18 months before. At the St. Martin's College of Art, I just thought, oh, you know, something's happening here. So we just played Literally Anytime Anywhere. We just played all the clubs in London, Mount Marquee and Vortex and stuff, and then regionally came up all around the country and some of Europe. So it was just playing wherever we could.
And the rest is history.
Yeah.
What were your musical influences back then?
Very varied, really. I mean, at home, my mum used to play Sinatra and Johnny Mathis and all the sort of ballad singers and stuff, so that was all going in. And we had a lady used to come and look after me, babysit, and she liked Gene Vincent and Eddie Cochran and Elvis. And then later on with me, I very much was interested in, glam rock, so it was like really Roxy Music for my favourite band of all of them. I thought they offered something a bit different. It was kind of art rock. They cover, you know, the lyrics were wonderful in it, and everyone looked forward to the new album cover. And so that was, I'd say they were my big influences, and people like Jonathan Richman in the USA, Modern Lovers, people like that. And yeah, so I've always been a music lover, so I learned from those who go before.
So you're more of a 70s child than an 80s child, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the thing is, Adam and the Ants always get collared with this new romantic thing, which we certainly weren't. There was nothing new or romantic about it. So, but really, I'd say post-punk. Post-punk is more, sits easy with me. But I think, you know, there was something very exciting happened in Great Britain in 1970, late 76, early 77, that I think was possibly the last great effort creatively that really was a whole sort of movement that really changed a lot of stuff.
How would you describe your genre of music? Would you put it in that category, in the kind of punk music?
I'd say punk, post-punk. You know, we were pretty much, we started out working with Susie and the Banshees. We used to go out with them. We were the support band with Susie, because quite simply, Susie Sue didn't have a back line. They didn't have an instrument, so we did. So they lent their amplifiers and borrow our drums and everything, and I became very good friends with Kenny Morris, their drummer. It wasn't let's say, welcomed by a lot of people, but I think that edge, that idea that, you know, you had to, you know, do these concerts when not everybody was loving it, and you had to sort of prove yourself, made it last, really, you know, because I still, every night, I still imagine I'm on stage in somewhere in some club somewhere in 1977, it keeps me on my toes, you know.
And that gig circuit, there was the Vortex, wasn't it, that you mentioned on your website, the Roxy and the Marquee, things like that.
Sadly all closed now.
Yes.
There's only one club left in London, and that's the 100 Club, which I actually went back to a year ago, virtually, in the next couple of days. Last year, I did the Hammersmith Apollo.
Mm-hmm.
We sold that out. We did the Dirt Wears White Socks, the first album in sequence, but also I did an extra show at the 100 Club, where I did a kind of homage to Elvis, his 68 comeback, and I invited the players that played that night and a couple of guests like John Ellis from the Vibrates to come and have a sit down, and I filmed that, and that's going to come out on Record Store Day, the DVD. So, you know, it's a shame, because the 100 Club's the only one left, and it's not necessarily the best one. The Marquee, I thought, was a wonderful club.
Awesome.
It all started for me at the 100 Club, the Marquee, rather, in Wardour Street, the residency that I used to play every Tuesday night, and it kind of built from there. That was the real opportunity I had that sadly young bands haven't got.
I think that was the Lyceum as well, wasn't it? That was in London as well.
We sold that out. I mean, before we had a hit record, we were selling the Lyceum out, and sort of two nights at the Empire, the Electric Ballroom in Camden, which is still open. I think it's tragic, really. I mean, even Denmark Street, they've not let down, which historic me, I think it's worth keeping, because that was Tim Tonelli. I wrote all my albums down there in the basement down there. You know, all the artists used to write their songs down there, you know, from the Beatles and the Stones, who used to write, and they're just knocking that all down. So there's a campaign out at the moment to kind of stop that happening.
And you got that deal with Decca, which produced a bunch of demos. Young Parisians was one, wasn't it?
I mean, I did the double A side, really, and I should have. Really, Lady would have been the one that would have been most appropriate, because that's like a fast one. But I put Young Parisians out quite deliberately to try and, you know, show that it wasn't going to be the normal four to the floor fare. But I think with new bands, you know, the way I'm approaching it is there are a lot of really good bands out there. So after the Hammersmith show last year, I did four nights at a lovely venue called the Islington Assembly Hall. Mm-hmm. And I put on two new bands a night. So eight new bands, and on this tour I'm taking two young bands, Shoes and of Empires, but just two. But there were bands like, you know, Night Engines, Savage Nomads, Caesars, Missy LePink, you know, the you know, Telegram, and some of those bands are now headlining their own the Enemy festivals and stuff. So really, I think it's for the artist to actually take out young bands, and that's the only opportunity they've got to get in the scene now, you know. And if you can do that, it's a lovely feeling to do it, because I like them, but I check 60 bands to get eight.
And then the back of the Xerox tour came the Dirk Wears White Socks album, a debut album, brilliant album. I was listening to it this week to remind myself of the music that was on there, and I've forgotten all about it. And I remember that track, Never Trust a Man with an Egg on His Face.
Yeah.
Where did the title of that come from?
I was living in a very, very small room. I call it a room. It wasn't really. It was actually filled as a half-landing flat. It was a broom cupboard. It was literally about 5 foot wide by about 12 foot long. But I loved it. I wrote all of Dirk in there, and actually Arthur Kings of Wild Frontier in there. But I was watching a science fiction film, this tiny little television set I had, and there was a thing about this monster from outer space, and it looked like an omelette. And so I kind of got the idea, and I like science fiction.
Yes.
So I thought I'd put a slot in it, and also it was a slow song. I mean, I think Dirk Wears White Socks, obviously I'm listening to it myself, to, you know, remind myself of what to sing and remember the lyrics, but it's not really a punk record at all. It's quite a jazzy record. I mean, there's seven key changes in one song. There's sort of time changes, and that was surprised to me to listen to it now. It really doesn't fit in anywhere, and I think it's taken sort of 35 years exactly for people to start understanding it, including me.
And the music scene's so differently now, isn't it? Like with Spotify and iTunes and social media, it's a lot different today than what it was back then.
Yeah, I think there's going to be a change there. I mean, you know, there's this new sort of thing that some of the big artists are getting together, you know, to try and combat that, because I think Spotify and that, all those things, it's all very good, but the people that are giving us that aren't considering the idea that, you know, music is not free to make. You have to pay money to make the record, you know. And the way their attitude is, oh, like this wonderful global family where everything's free in some kind of utopia as long as they're making all the cash. And there's got to be a fight back, but it's very hard to police the internet. But I think what that does do is, I don't think people realise, when you write a song, I mean, I wrote those songs you just played, and that's what's paying for my, you know, my daughter's education now. When people download it for free, you don't get that, and so it's probably one of those ideas that, oh, well, you know, you're rich enough, but that's not the case. What about the young band? So really, I think the internet has to be policed more, and the Apple's really, you know, it's kind of good that the artists themselves have got back to put together to try and make conditions better for you know, not only the public, but also for the people that write the songs. You know, it costs quite a lot of money to write a song, you know.
It's a lot different in those days, going back to the vinyl days. When did you first learn about your chart position, when the charts came out?
I remember specifically, I was in central London. I was in a basement flat, staying with a friend of mine called Jordan, who actually was our manager at the time, and it came through. My manager there was a guy called Falcon Stewart, who sadly passed away. He's the manager of X-Ray Specs. And there was some interest from CBS, as it was, at our Sony, because they'd heard Car Trouble, and they wanted to sign us, and my publishers at EMI, Royal Frontier. Didn't really make the top. And then Dog Eat Dog got to 39 in the charts, and somebody dropped out of the Top of the Pops show, and we got our slot, and overnight I sold a quarter million album of singles, and that was it. I mean, the rest was history, as it were, and that opportunity to go on Top of the Pops, I think, is sadly missing now. There does need to be a broadcast one weekly show where, you know, the whole family sit around and watch it, you know, everybody watches it, and it's going to be quite hard to do, because basically you can't do it based on the charts, because the charts is all R&B. So I would think that we'd split into sections where you had, you know, the actual chart itself, but within that, an indie section and a mature section, like an MR section, and try and have some kind of way so that it was as broad a chart as it was, you know.
Out of all the music that you recorded, do you have a favourite? Is there one that you like performing the most?
Well, they're all like children. It's just you let them out, once you let them out, they're on their own. I still love, the thing is, whenever I sing these songs, I'm trying to get them right, because the Adam and the Ant sound, the sound was very much a kind of hybrid, and layers of vocals. I used to do layers of vocals and mix them down, and on Kings of Our Frontier, actually, the track itself, it was 18 tracks of drums out of 24 tracks. So all the vocals, guitars and everything had to be split into the other tracks, because, you know, doing that live is impossible. But we do play 100% live, but you have to kind of get it as close as you can. So every single night I'm singing it, I'm thinking of the original. I'm thinking, well, that could be better. So you're always pushing. But these shows, I'm doing, you know, I'm doing, going around doing a dozen shows. I did five in London, and I'm really going back to the places that I, where Dirt Wears White Socks was born as an album, you know, and Norwich and Warwick and Northampton and Manchester, and on Record Store Day, I will be in Liverpool at a record store, as I was last year at Rough Trade and in Soho, to actually be at an independent record store, you know, with the CD and the vinyl, mentioned vinyl earlier, I mean, that again is a labour of love, and that is on the growing side of things.
It is, yes.
And I've done, fortunately, I have a very good relationship with Sony, and I plan to remaster and re-release, the next one will be Kings of Our Frontier, because Dirt Wears White Socks was a really good success for me, having my own label, Blue Black Is Art, and we did it in white vinyl, and it's got posters and stickers from the time in it. It's been remastered, and we're doing the same with Kings, so we're doing a double gold A-side of Kings of Our Frontier, and music will be released on Record Store Day. And I think that's indicational of, like, the effort that comes from the artist. So when you put a record out, it is like a child, and you've got to, you know, love it. And if you get the opportunity to get it back into the fold and do it again, and you know, it's like a director getting the original footage back from the studio and doing the director's cut. That's exactly what it's like, and that's what I've got license to do. So Kings of Our Frontier will be the next one, and then do the other five.
Now, this Dirk Wears White Socks tour, it continues on Wednesday in Brighton at the Concord. For all our listeners, all the details are on our website, all the W's, thebridgeradio.net, and you can purchase tickets from our website. How do you prepare for such a tour?
It's a bit like a boxer, really. I was very lucky to do some training with Chris Eubank a couple of years ago, and he gave me a few tips on how to sort of keep fit and stay in shape. So it's really, I look at it as the rehearsals are done, you've got the kind of 30, 40 songs in your head, then it comes to the physical side. So it's almost like getting ready for a contest. So, you know, I started, you know, 6 weeks ago getting myself sorted, mainly walking. I've got a dog. I've got two dogs, actually, but it's great to go out and walk them every day. Walking's very good. It clears my mind. And then I do a sort of light training routine at home, which is more or less stretching and lifting very light weights at home. So I don't like gymnasiums at all. I don't like them at all. I think they're horrible places. You know, they're intimidating, and I don't like them at all. So I've worked out a system of my own, but it's good to have a focus and a deadline.
Yes, yes. As we say, it starts on Wednesday in Brighton, then there's Southampton, Bristol, Reading. You're here in the Midlands at Wolverhampton on the 16th at the Civic Hall, then Manchester, Liverpool, as you mentioned, Norwich, Leeds, Nottingham, Warwick and Northampton, a busy month. And then you're off abroad somewhere?
Yeah, I might take a little break after that, but then the next thing's I'm working now on the Kings of Our Frontier box set, and I've just finished the last track of my new album, which will be out probably early next year, called Bravest of the Brave. 13 new songs that I've written and produced. So there's kind of three things going at the same time. You have to, sounds a lot, but it's, you know, you just have to work in kind of sequence, really. So it keeps me busy, keeps me out of trouble.
Yes, we wish you every success with this tour. When you're in the front, give us a wave. We'll always be on the front row. We'll give you a wave. It's the 16th of April here in Wolverhampton and at the Civic Hall. For all our listeners, I say the ticket details for all the venues are on our website, allthews.thebridgeradio.net. Adam from Adam and Yance, we wish you every success. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me, and I wish everybody a happy Sunday, and have a rest like I am today.
So, thanks for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you in the Midlands Fed very shortly. Cheers.
Thanks very much. Bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.